Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Klippel's free webinar series, Acoustical Measurement of Sound System Equipment According to IEC 60268-21. This week's episode, Benchmarking of Audio Products Under Standard Conditions, is the 12th episode. Wow, fantastic. I see many of the same sign-in IDs week after week, and while I may not know all of you personally, it is great to see so many of you taking advantage of these webinars. Good on you. We're also seeing some new people signing in who are just getting a chance to listen to these informationally packed webinars for the first time. Welcome. If you are new to these, make sure that you go back and listen to the videos from the first and invite your friends. If you have ever been to a trade show and Wolfgang Klippel is in the booth, you know how much enjoyment he gets out of discussing industry topics, but also you can see how busy he is with people waiting in line for a bit of his time and opinion. He knows, look at him. And this is a great chance to hear him discuss the state of our industry and applicable measurements. And it's free. I'm telling you, there's great enjoyment going back and listening to the videos when you're relaxed and you can have a nice cold beer. It's very satisfying. Let's get things started. Remember to use the Q&A button below for your questions, and I will relay them to Wolfgang when I can, and in the order received. If we don't get to a specific question during the webinar, I try to do my best and get to it during the discussion at the end. Good afternoon, good doctor. I hope you are well.
I'm well.
The screen is yours.
Yeah, okay, let's switch over to my screen. Okay, we had already 11 sections. We started actually really with a new idea of doing output-based measurements, and then we spent a lot of time with acoustical measurements in a normal room. Finally, we discussed in greater detail all kinds of distortion measurement, and the last one was about the pitfalls with wireless audio devices. Here you see the varying latency and other problems. Now we are coming, I would say, to a new section, which is the application of this new standard ideas and possibilities in practice. And the first interesting thing is the benchmarking of audio products, but mainly under standard conditions. So the physical measurements are quite important. In the next sessions, we are coming to the perceptual things. What are the topic today? First of all, we speak a little bit about selecting essential physical characteristics matrix measurements, which work at low and high frequencies. And then I will present the need for benchmarking, some ideas, some backgrounds, and some new solutions. The first method for benchmarking can be used without having a measurement system, just getting information, meaningful information from the supplier. Yeah. The second one is very convenient if you are an important customer and you claim this device, which should be developed by a supplier, should produce a certain maximum output. You claim that and you give here the supplier a lot of freedom for doing his best. Finally, we come to the third method. That's very much related with the rating of max SPL. Rating, then the person who is doing the rating has some freedom and some responsibilities. And that simplifies very much the benchmarking, you will see. That's quite interesting, very important. And I show it here on a second Bluetooth speaker. So we have two of them. So it's a simple but a good test for comparing to Bluetooth devices. So that's our plan for today. And we are starting immediately to warm you a little bit up with a poll. How do you benchmark your audio products? That's the question. You can click on multiple choices. You can be honest and say, I have never done it. Then you say, comparing just technical specification provided by the manufacturer or doing performing by yourself some physical measurements on the devices and comparing the results, or just listening to the product reproducing your favorite audio samples. So we get already some results here. We have to wait. Some persons have to think about that. It's interesting. Up to now, nobody, all of them have already done it. So in A, we have none. Then comes your comparing technical specification. 50% of all the people are doing that. And finally, performing physical measurements, that's the majority, that is almost or more than 75%. And finally, of course, everybody is listening to the product. So we are just at the right topic, I see it. It would be a little bit embarrassing for me if everyone is on A. It's a hot topic. Let's start with the characteristics, the measurement matrix for describing the performance of the audio device. Of course, it is cost, but that plays today a minor role. We are coming back on this later. Then comes very primitive physical characteristics, size, volume, shape, weight, and the maximum output. That's already a little bit more challenging. That's a max SPL, or the maximum output power, something like that. And finally, the efficiency in percent. That means the ratio between input power and acoustical output. Yeah, and then we have here a next section. That's, of course, perceptual audio quality. That means the spectral and spatial properties, the distortion. You see, we are still on the physical ground, in the physical domain, but we try to use a measurement system to evaluate the perceptual audio quality. Then one topic very important for, say, manufacture of cars and other expensive audio devices, reliability of the transducer, for instance, and then we have the endurance of external stress, overload, environment, also climate and other things. So this is quite important. And then we have some other things. I will not speak today about that, but this is also important for the performance and the end value of an audio device. Here you see it, artistic product design, technical story, if you are a good storyteller, reputation of the brand, personal identification with the product, and a lot of enjoyment is important. So that's our topic today, more or less physical measurements. Later on in the next sessions, we are coming to the other stuff. Our next poll. What is important for your benchmarking? You can already also put multiple choices or click on multiple choices. Maximum output represented by the SPL or by the maximal acoustical output, efficiency, perceptual audio quality in all kinds, reliability, endurance. Yeah, I think that's it. I have to make it again here. Reliability, endurance. So we get already the result, of course, that I expected, that the sound quality C is quite important. That are almost 90%. Then follows the maximum output, SPL max with 60%. And then comes to the same share, efficiency and reliability. It's quite interesting that reliability is important for many participants here in our workshop. And of course, the endurance also appears here with 26%. Okay, we have a feeling that those characteristics are important. And now, if we are speaking about benchmarking, we see it's challenging. It is a very complex job, and we have to find some ways to simplify that. And of course, we can make it simpler by comparing similar products. more or less headphones or a group of headphones, something like that. Or we have a very clear definition what is the final group of end users. For instance, teenagers, and the color is maybe very important and it should be loud enough or something like that. Okay, then we have to specify the final application condition. Maybe it's an in-ear phone or something like that. And we have to select a minimum number of essential metrics evaluating important properties. That's quite important. If you have too many, you are just lost in the numbers, in the different things and so on. Yeah. So. Use metrics which are clearly defined, for instance, in the standard. That's quite important if you later on have a dispute with a supplier or with a customer, then it's easy that you can refer, it's very clear defined how I'm doing the measurement and so on. No? Okay. That, and we have an next thing, define the evaluation condition. For instance, the input level. You know, that's related also to the SPL Max. Okay, that seems clear. And here we see a list of important standard characteristics, which are very nice suited for standard measurements. They are a little bit away from the target condition. We are not in a listening room. We are not in a car. We are really close to an anechoic room, or we have possibilities to fulfill here the standards which are listed here on this. Yeah, first of all, this group are parameters. What means that? Parameters are based on a model, and they are usually, or they should be, independent on the stimulus. So it should not matter that you are measuring here the fundamental transfer function with a chirp or with a multi-tone signal, or even with music, it should not matter. In reality, it has an influence, but the parameters should not have that. Yeah, there are other things like 3D output directivity, impedance, and lump parameters. Lump parameter measurement, to do that on an output-based style is quite challenging. That's usually done with an impedance measurement, with an electrical thing here. Okay. And then we have some symptoms. Here we need a test signal, a certain stimulus. Here for the amplitude compression, we can use almost everything. But for the harmonic distortion measurement, we need a sinusoidal input signal, a single tone, maybe with varying frequencies, like like a chirp or a step sign stimulus and so on, or multi-tone with multiple tones, and some other measurements. And then we have here some rated characteristics. Rated means more or less the user has, according to some requirements, the freedom to define this number fulfilling some requirements. Yeah, that can be applied for the maximum displacement and for the maximum SPL or input voltage. And finally, we have some long-term testing. You see, we need here usually a broadband signal simulating the normal audio signal, and it takes some time, like here, 100-hour testing and other things. More funny stuff to maybe damage the speaker and see the influence of heat and a very low temperature. Okay. This here is a very, very interesting number. Here's the SPL max and the U max. That's more or less the reason why we are doing this live webinar here. It simplifies the benchmarking. It's a very useful thing to consider that. I would like to explain that why. Here you see the range of operation. Blue means cool, small signal domain. Red means dangerous, very hot, very nonlinear. Maybe here we are generating a damage of the speaker. And you see already the magnitude of the stimulus has a dramatic impact on the performance of the audio device. Yeah. So in the small signal performance is a little bit boring, but very nice, because the distortion which we are measuring here, they actually they should be independent over a wide working range, and actually they are not linear if they are changing at higher amplitudes. So at medium and high amplitudes, we see some other interesting stuff. And here the rated maximum SPR level according to the IEC standard 62.68-1 may be very useful for doing some measurements. And here some selected signal distortion. We have first of all, and they are depending on the level. Yeah, that's quite important. Time varying distortion due to heating, aging. We can measure that also with a compression measurement according to the standard. We have here irregular distortion, undesired one. They cannot be modeled. And the impulsive distortion measurement according to the IEC standard is a very nice way to get a very good understanding of those problems. And finally, we have here the nonlinear distortion. You know, maybe the total harmonic distortion, THD, multitone distortion, and intermodulation distortion. We have discussed this in greater detail in the sections, let's see, 7 up to 10. Yeah. Okay. We are using here for calibrating our measurement device, usually a broadband signal that can be represented by a multitone complex. That's quite nice, but we are using also for the harmonic measurements, usually a chirp at different amplitudes. Yeah, and then we see what happens here with our distortion in the large signal domain. Yeah, there are significant changes expected here. Yeah, I said already the rated SPL or rated voltage is quite important for the benchmarking. Now let's start at the low amplitudes. The measurement conditions are quite simple. We go 20 dB down from the maximum voltage, then we are safe. We are at sufficiently low voltage. We see almost no nonlinear effects. We are using a broadband stimulus just to measure or evaluate the frequency response at all frequencies. And then we have selected points on axis in the listening zone or under far field, free field condition. Yeah. Okay, we have discussed this already in the first sections 2, 3, 4 and so on, if you are interested in that. And now some interesting metrics for linear distortion. One is already defined in the standard here 62.68-21. It's just the upper and lower limit of the frequency range where the mean SPR level or with the sound frequency response drops down from the mean level by 10 dB. Yeah, we have discussed that. Then we have the SPR response estimated from also an estimated room response considering different room reflections and the sound power response according to the CA standard smoothed by 1/3 octave. And we have a new idea. It's the idea is not new, but the standard activity is new. There is a new IEC project which determines the mean deviation of the SPL level in the frequency response from a target response, which is usually flat. That's interesting for TV and monitor application in this project. Yeah, this is a slide which I have also already presented in section 3. Here you see the most important curves proposed by Floyd Toole and John Olive. That's on-axis response, then the listening window response, early reflection. Here you see which points are averaged. And of course, we get with a horizontal and vertical measurement a good idea of the radiated sound power response. So this is this one here, and the ratio between on-axis and sound power, that's actually the sound power directivity index. That are very useful linear things, and summarizing some of them gives the estimated room response. Okay, that's one thing. And here is are the new metrics which are currently under discussion. One is the sound balance. That means we check more or less the ratio between the mean level at low frequencies and the mean level at higher frequencies, and calculate from that more or less the steepness of the amplitude response. Then we are calculating the variation of the SPL response versus frequency. We will discuss that that is then describes as a flatness, which is just the inverse thing. So that the name is maybe not perfect for describing the standard deviation of the SPL in different bands. Yeah, and finally, we have the SPL uniformity in the near field at different measurement points. That's important for big TV monitors. Yeah, let's summarize here the essential metrics. You, of course, yeah, you can invent many more metrics. What is really important and what is easy to measure and what is already defined in standards? We have the lower limit of the effective frequency range. That's directly related with the resonance frequency or the box tuning and so on. So if we get the decay at low frequencies, then we have the variance of the SPL response versus frequency. That's the opposite thing from flatness. And then we have here the sound balance. What is a good idea? That's maybe related to the brightness and bass enhancement, also the ratio of the two things. And then we have the upper limit of the effective frequency range. And there are many other things which should be considered, maybe also the latency and the sound power directivity index, what is quite useful. Yeah, that's perceived as a coloration here that contributes to the sharpness and that to the low bass performance. We will speak about the perceptual and cognitive things in the next sections in greater detail. Okay, that's easy. That was small signal performance. Now we are coming to the difficult stuff. That's at higher amplitudes. Here we use the maximum SPL or maximum voltage to define the large signal measurement. And there are three different interesting ways to evaluate or to measure the speaker. First, we are doing the testing on different max SPL levels. We have different devices. They are designed with a different intention, with different material from different engineers, and maybe they highly depend on the individual max SPL. That's why, to be fair, we have to do the measurement at this level. Yeah. And this is rated by the supplier. He says this device is good for this level. Yeah, that's one. The second method is, I told you already in the introduction, very interesting for important customers. They have the power to define the max SPL target. That's more or less a product environment. I would like to see for this broadband signal simulated with a multitone complex, I would like to see 85 dB in 1 meter. So that's a very good starting point for the design of the product. Yeah, and finally, we can compare the devices by rating the devices. So we are defining actually some criteria, some limits, distortion limits and other things. And then we are using the limits to find the maximum SPL for each box. So we end up with an important number, 1 dB, 2 dB. Might be very, very important because this is directly related of course, to the output, but it considers in a certain way the distortion performance and other things. So that's quite interesting. Okay, do we have some important questions or can I go on?
Please proceed.
Okay, then I go on. We start again with the essential metrics for the large signal performance. That's of course the maximum output represented by the max SPL. That should be measured with a broadband stimulus. That means it's not a chirp, because a chirp will only activate the speaker at a certain time, at a certain frequency. We need at least a multi-tone signal or dense noise. Then we would like to address or measure the time-variant properties. They have actually a low impact on audio quality, but a high impact on reliability, and of course an impact on the loudness. So that means if your device, like in smartphones or in with micro speakers, is always hot, you are always losing some output loudness. Yeah, that's the amplitude compression. Here we need also a broadband stimulus. But the impact on reliability is already a nice indicator that more or less the maximum output is limited. So we get a conflict between maximum output and very much amplitude compression. Then we have the regular nonlinearities and the regular distortion. They are part of the design. It is related to the money, how much magnet size you invest, how long is a coil, and so on. It's part of the design. It's accepted by the design. It has a very high impact on audio quality. Yeah, you can also measure that with a multi-tone distortion. It's actually a very universal stimulus. It represents any broadband audio signals. So it is much better than a chirp for attenuating the regular nonlinear distortion. So the THD are in the multitone and a lot of intermodulation distortion. Finally, we have the irregular properties. Nobody likes that. We have the bad name rub and buzz for that. The voice call is rubbing, something is buzzing, and other bad things are going on. We cannot model that. That's a difference to the regular nonlinearities. It's too complicated. We have spoken about that in section 10, if you are more interested. That has an even higher impact on audio quality and reliability than here the regular distortion and the compression. So it's a very, say, undesired critical thing. We have to consider that. Yeah, and here the impulse of distortion measurement with a chirp is a very sensitive way to get a good picture. Yeah, that's it. Now we are coming to the first method, benchmarking at individual max SPL. What is here the idea? We have different suppliers. They have no contact with each other. Maybe they are contacted from the customer in a different way. Yeah, and the customer asks the question, do you have any loudspeaker in this range? Can you send me a sample have you something already on the shelf? And he has. Of course, he has some speaker and he has already rated the SPL, but in a very different way, actually. And he has, of course, tested the loudspeaker at this level. So all the data are available and he can answer your email immediately. You get the data sheets, the spec, immediately after that. That's quite interesting. And everything is based on a standard, which gives you some freedom. It's quite important. So they have maybe modified a little bit the standards. That's completely allowed to just consider the particularities of each speaker a little bit. That are the individual modifications. Yeah, they are sending their data. And the customer says, oh, they are done under different measurement conditions. Maybe I save the time, I will not redo the measurement, but I could, because it could deliver the individual modifications of the standard, a clear description how they have done the measurement. If the customer has some doubts that the numbers are not correct, he can verify them quite easily. Yeah, okay, but usually they are correct, because he would produce a lot of trouble if he is cheating. Yeah, then comes the results, and now comes the difficult job for the customer to compare the different numbers. So that's a big disadvantage. He has measurements done in a different concept context, and now he has to compare the numbers. So the supplier determines the test condition. That's the thing. Yeah, and here you see how it works. You have here with our four selected most essential metrics. You have different numbers in SPL. You have different numbers in the compression, in the multi-tone distortion, with the impulsive distortion. Here they are maybe similar because they are quite good. Yeah, and now what comes out? Product B has more outputs, that's nice, but at the same time, product B generates a little bit of more distortion. Now you have to know how much this difference in SPL output, 1-2 dB, is worth for the small difference of distortion. So that's not quite simple. Here you see we need already some kind of tolerance scheme here, some tolerances on the metrics. We will speak about that here, setting meaningful tolerances here in section 14, but not today. Yeah, what is a background idea? Benchmarking at individual max SPL. The idea is best matching between different SPL and audio performance. You would like to trade one against the other. What are the benefits? The supplier is doing all the rating. He has a lot of background information, and maybe the SPL is meaningful for the particular product. Yeah, the benchmarking is based on existing products. So something should be measured. There is a sample available. You get maybe the sample in the next week. So everything is fast here because it is the data and the samples exist. Maybe there's even not a communication required with the supplier. Yeah, you get the sample somehow. Yeah, and there's a minimum test effort for the customer. That's quite nice. Yeah, that's maybe good if you are a hobbyist, for instance, you would like to get a nice transducer for your loudspeaker, then you can do that. No. What are the drawbacks? Comparison of DUTs with different SPL values and the distortion values is quite complicated. But what is the main application? Benchmarking based on data sheet published by a supplier. So if the data sheet is good, we can save a lot of time. So that's the main application. And now I would like to make a demo or give you an idea of the demo. Here you see we have today, two Bluetooth speakers. I spent all the time in the last sections here on the JBL Bluetooth speaker. We found out it's a quite nice product. It's not new, it's some years old. We found it here. And one reason was we would like to find two speakers which have almost the same volume. They have actually the same, almost the same volume. Why? Because this is a stereo speaker and we are not operating here the right speaker. We are using, only the left speaker, and then it's quite comparable. Yeah, and you will see that the performance is also very similar. No, yeah, and I did a lot of measurements, and you will see it very soon here in my database that I use. We use the near field scanner for the two devices discussed in the first sessions. Then I continued with the measurement here in my room on my table. I used the in situ room compensation with the reference data here from the near field scanner. We generated in situ immediately a room compensation function. I show it to you very soon. And then we used the room compensation function to actually synthetically generate perfect measurement condition, far field condition, free field condition here in my office. Yeah, and we use the chirp measurement with a stepping feature and of course a multi-tone measurement. So that's it. Now I'm switching over here to the DB lab. That's here. Okay, I should close here everything. We are now here in section benchmarking. And I close the second benchmarking at the same level. We are here in the first method. And now you see here the two speakers. Arctic is a competitor. rated as a max SPL of 75.5 dB and the JBL max SPL rated with 74. I did that actually with some background information. Actually, the background information are generated with a method discussed here in the third step. Okay, you see already the competitor has 1.5 dB more than the JBL. Okay, today I do no measurements with the JBL. That's it's working. We are doing all the measurement on the Arctic. That's a black box. Now we are here in the near field on the table, 30 centimeter distance. Yeah. And actually now my first step is to generate simulated far field condition. That starts actually here with far field SPL response coming from the near field scanner. So that's a highly accurate measurement, also measured in a normal room, but with a holographic measurement. It is discussed here in section two. Yeah. Okay. We are using that as a difference curve as a to generate at lower frequencies. Here you see the room measurement. It is not so smooth than the other measurement. To make it a little bit smaller, compare that with that. That's here our free field measurement at 30 centimeter. And that's here the measurement in the room. Yeah, we see here a lot of variation in the frequency responses. Peak here at 300 Hertz corresponds with that, but we have almost 20 dB variation here at lower frequencies. It becomes better at higher frequencies. So in the in situ measurement here, I can actually I can press a button, then, or maybe I'm explaining here this nice picture. That's our technique here we are using. We get from the near field scanner the reference curve. That's here the reference curve from the near field scanner, but we are using this curve only at lower frequencies, actually to this frequency range where you see cross range up here to 1 kilohertz. Why? Because at higher frequencies, the positioning of the microphone is so critical that we should use here a different technique. We are using here the windowing technique, which works quite nicely. It's very robust, simple. It is more or less used over 20, 30 years. So it's a very nice way to generate at higher frequencies a good reference curve or the true curve, but at lower frequencies, we use a reference curve from the near field scanner. Then we are combining that and dividing this reference curve by the bad curve, which have been measured here in situ, here the black one. No? And from that, we get this room correction curve. And this room correction curve is used now directly, immediately after the microphone to remove the room impact and to transform, that's the next thing, our measurement point from the near field at 30 centimeters into the standard evaluation point at 1 meter. We can do it because we have a correct reference curve for 30 centimeters and for 1 meter, and we can combine them and consider that in the room correction curve. And we do another thing. In the standard, we need a full space measurement. That's also done here in the free field measurement at here at 30 centimeters in this curve. So they are actually not comparable with the half space measurement. Yeah, the half space measurement is done here on the table. So it's completely different. Everything is compensated, and this is done here in the room correction curve. So three things are compensated: room reflections, half space measurement, distance. Yeah, and then I take this curve here into the clipboard. Very simple. I go here. Maybe I do it. I go here. To, oh, Oh, let's go to the live demo. That's maybe more interesting. I have to take this one here because if you change the microphone position, this room curve is a little bit different, and I should consider this copy curve. I go here into that, into the multi-tone measurement, and under processing, under microphone, you could call it is a microphone correction. It's not really. We are doing more than that. We are compensating also, if you like, not only the microphone problems, but also room problems and other things. So that's now imported. And now I can measure. Here's a multi-tone measurement very quickly for you. That's here done at a fixed voltage of 100 millivolt. Here you see I have spoken during the noise floor measurements. That was a silent measurement at the beginning. That's why the measurement is here corrupted. But the second measurement, I heard the signal, I immediately stopped. But maybe we have to redo that. It goes quite quickly. And I should not speak now. So the first part was a noise measurement. Now you see our noise level is very down and it's close to the distortion level here from the loudspeaker. And that is here the fundamental component, which is a typical multi-tone signal. And it is relatively flat. We have removed the 20 dB variation, which we found here in the in-situ measurement. Yeah. So that's almost a very good measurement. Now let's do the next step. The next step is actually search for the input value. That's more or less a calibration routine, generating the target SPL value. So the target SPL level was 75.5 dB. I entered this number here in the target value. Now I have only for safety, the maximum voltage, maybe it should be somewhere here. It should be voltage range. And I selected the fast range. I don't see the voltage. You can apply a safety voltage. No, it doesn't matter. I don't find it at the moment. So I'm starting that and you will see what happens. We are doing multiple measurement, but I have to keep my, I should not speak too much. Okay. First measurement. Second measurement. So we reached now, you have seen, we have increased the voltage with a very fast surge. That's here the task. So that's not regular stepping. That's with some smart algorithms that we find as fast as we can, the maximum output. Here we found it. We are very close to the target value. That's close enough. And here you see the maximum input voltage, 440 millivolt. Yeah. At the analog input. So, and then you see here at the same time how much compression we have generated. That's below 1 dB. And we found here distortion, multi-tone distortion. Maybe I show you the whole thing. By the way, you see here already that's here the fundamental. And that other distortion now, where they are, here they are. Yeah, and now we are calculating based on Floyd, Alexander Voigt-Willow here, a mean value that's more or less a smooth curve. And this smooth curve is our multi-tone distortion curve. Maybe here I make it large. Yeah. Yeah. This curve here. That was here at lower voltages, a little bit lower. That was here in the small signal domain. No? Okay. And here we are searching for, let's see, I think for the mean value, no, for the maximum distortion to the maximum value here in this frequency band. The frequency band we are searching is here shown by the blue curve. So above 100 Hertz and below 10 kilohertz. And it's maybe, I would say, this value here at 400 hertz or something like that. Yeah, let's see, maximum distortion about minus 30 dB. That's correct. Okay, that's it. Then we did some impulsive distortion measurement. Maybe I can duplicate the measurement that goes quite quickly. Let's duplicate that. The first measurement is done with two chirps in the TRF. The reason is to measure here the steady state condition. So that means there are compressors in it, and by playing the chirp with a pre-loop and then comes a real measurement loop, we know that more or less the compressor is activated. And then I did, of course, a measurement only with one chirp to see how the attack system in the compressor and in the protection system works. Now maybe I should duplicate here. Well, I did it already. I duplicate the measurement. I have selected here the critical voltage, which I found here on with the multi-tone signal. That's 48 volt, and I can easily put it here in my stepping. I would like to make the measurement only at one voltage. That means the start voltage and the end voltage are identical, so it goes quite quick. But I should keep my, oh no, sorry, something is wrong. This measurement here should be actually done. I have to stop the measurement in the near field. Why? Because we need maximum signal to noise ratio for the rub and bus measurement, which is important here. We are not so much interested in the frequency response. We have it already here in the normal measurement under simulated free field condition. Now we are interested in rub and bus. I hope it works. Let's see. You heard two chirps. And now we are calculating a little bit. Why? Because now we are doing many interesting analysis here in that. Maybe I can also, now it comes. First of all, we see here the total harmonic distortion in percentage. That's more or less a normal value. So at lower frequencies where the fundamental goes down, we have a very, very high value. I can explain it quite simple in the normal TRF here. Here you see in the near field, we see not much from the room. Yeah, I expand the window. That's, thanks, Andrew. That's here the fundamental. And here we are now close between the passive radiator and the normal transducer. And here is a dip in the frequency response. That's only in the near field. In the far field, it's gone. We have not seen it here in the under simulated far field condition. No, it's not really a cancellation point, but here we have a cancellation point a little bit. Oh no, that's this one here. Huh? No, it was correct. It's only small. And that's why our fundamental is small, the distortions are high. We have a crazy number of THD. I can open that here. Maybe you see the harmonic distortion in the TRF. It's about 60%. That's just the problem that the fundamental is down. So be careful with harmonic distortion as a relative measure in percentage. If you have no fundamental, you get a lot of distortion. Yeah, but here in the stepping, we see some other interesting results. Also not only the total harmonic distortion, we can transform the distortion from the output to the input. That are the equivalent input distortions. They are very meaningful. Why? Because we have removed all the acoustical say shaping from the room, from the loudspeaker, we are actually now very close to the source of the distortion, which is close to the input. I've discussed that here under harmonic distortion measurement in section 8. The funny thing is that 5%, it's not much happening here. By the way, here at the dip, where the sound pressure goes down here at 100 hertz, we have also not much equivalent input distortion. But the total harmonic distortion in percentage tells you that you have 80%. But the loudspeaker produces here only 2%. The point is, due to the shaping from the linear system, we get this crazy number here. That's post-shaping. Yeah, and the funny idea is, this is that are the, actually the nonlinear distortion, which should be synthesized by a nonlinear control system to linearize, to cancel the distortion. It's not much what we need for the speaker. Yeah, that's that. Then we have here some higher order distortions. They are starting, let's see here under the setup, from the sixth order up to the 24th order. But this is not very sensitive. So, more important is the peak value the peak value of the residuum. That is more or less the impulsive distortion ratio here at the blue curve. Refer to the mean measurement. We are here minus 40 dB down at lower frequencies. That's here a problem from the room reflections. Let's go back to the normal TRF. Then I show it to you. That's also here in the normal fundamental window. That's here the mean value. Where's the mean value? Here. We are averaging that at about 115 dB. And then here are the peak value, also on the absolute scale, from the impulsive distortion. And we have here a difference of minus 40 dB. And that's actually a lot. And the loudspeaker is working quite well here at this level. And then we have another interesting thing, that's a crest factor of this kind, or maybe I show for a moment also the residuum. That's all that is handled here in the other section. Here you see the sound pressure time signal. This is here measured from the microphone, that's modeled. We have subtracted the two signals, and if I zoom into that, then you see here the difference, the error signal, that are the impulsive distortion. And we are reading here the peak value, the RMS value, and the crest factor. And you see here already at here in one period, that's here one period, we have already some impulsive distortions. They are very small, but they are impulsive. And that's actually shown here as black spots in the waveform of the sound pressure signal. So that's more or less here in Pascal, you could say, the positive and negative waveform of the sound pressure. And the color is a crest factor. If it is below 10 dB, it's yellow, red, green, it doesn't matter. If it becomes larger than 10, then we get the black spots. What means we get already some artifacts actually from the compressor. That's the idea. Yeah, this is more or less the idea. Now I have done the same measurements also, maybe here with a single chirp measurement. It looks a little bit more impulsive. You see it also already in the step measurement. Here the green curve is the crest factor. It's now about, I make it large for you, it's here about 18 dB. And in the dual measurement, it's much smaller. The green curve is at 14 dB or 15 dB. That corresponds with the yellow, red picture showing you the black spots with the crest factor. So it becomes impulsive. I did the same measurement here for the JBL that's in the other folder, but I should go back to the summary where you see a nice overview what I have measured with the JBL one. So, do you have questions here to the DB Lab, to the measurement?
Nothing concerning DB Lab at this point. Okay. We've got a couple questions brewing, but proceed, please.
Okay, let's go on here. That was our measurement. Okay, here are the results again. That's maximum SPL, JBL, 74 dB, and the competitor, the Arctic, 1.5 dB more, different values. Compression, actually more compression from the competitor at this level, less compression here from JBL. No? The same, the competitor has more distortion. We are not down at minus 36. If you remember, it was minus 30 dB. Yeah. And now to the impulsive distortion, both speakers were quite good. So our, say, peak value was minus 40 dB. That's more than enough. But we have seen already some smaller impulsive distortion from the Arctic, but we have seen with pre-loop, with dual chirps, with activation of the protection, no impulsive distortion with the JBL. So it was not peaky at all. Yeah. Okay, the competitor, that was completely acceptable. And now you have to make your decision, what is better, what is worse. It's quite difficult. Maybe you like, here's a 1.5 dB, but you have to pay for distortion and compression. No? Okay, here's the same measurement, but only with a single loop. And then you see both speakers have changed. They have, fortunately, not generated significant peaky distortion on the peak level. It's almost the same. It's good. But we see already in both speakers some peaky distortions. That comes from the compressor. And maybe we have a hard time to avoid that. But they are quite critical for also for the perceptual quality and something like that. Okay. Second, we are speaking about this in later sections, if the audibility comes in. Second method, or do you have questions to the first method?
There's a few questions. One of the questions that I've pondered quite often is, and this might be more of a discussion, but obviously we're benchmarking some Bluetooth speakers here.
Yes.
And is there any conversation or direction in the specification for a 2-pi measurement as opposed to a 4-pi measurement? If you're measuring this in an anechoic chamber or on the near field scanner, the size of that baffle, or should it be done in an infinite baffle? I think the question is, all of these products are typically used in a 2-pi environment anyhow. They're small enough to be used on a desk or on a kitchen counter or kitchen, wherever. So I'm just curious if there's any conversation about that.
Your introduction is already quite useful. That means we have to start this discussion from the application condition. And if this is on a table like here, we should actually generate usually should do the measurement, even the near field scanning measurement on a baffle in a half space, just to see some interactions with the speaker, with the half space and so on, just to be safe. And of course, or compare that with a full space measurement, but the half space measurement is most likely more relevant. Here in our case, Christian, as you remember here in the second session, did it in a full space, and we compensated here just by 6 dB, converted this to a half space measurement. That makes sense in this case, because our microphone is here on the ground. It's a ground floor measurement, more or less.
Right, right. Yeah? And of course, then you get questions of, okay, how big should that tabletop be in measurement in relation to the size of the dot?
The interesting point is, with a near field scanner, we can make a virtual infinite measurement, because we measure just around the speaker,
right,
and we don't see the edges of the measurement. if you do the measurement in a real room, in a half space room, the room should be large enough, maybe 3, 5, 10 meters. Oh, nah, 10 meters, not 3 meters at least.
Right. Good.
You
good
go
answer.
To the ground. Yeah.
Right. We can't even discuss how many party goers are standing around dancing around the speaker, but we'll get into that. No, we won't.
So, another, or we can keep the other question for the
right,
discussion.
Carry on. Absolutely. Thank you.
The next method. Here, the customer is mighty powerful. He claims he would like, he requires a certain max SPL and gives that with other requirements to the suppliers. And he also specifies, the target application and the test condition, the criteria, limits and something, priorities and all that, and gives that to the suppliers. And they are doing also the testing with that and giving this product, maybe the sample, and the test results to the customer. The customer is always in green here. Yeah, this is our customer. He can repeat the measurement. He can evaluate that. Maybe he will do that because he has the samples. He has the time for doing that. And then he does the comparison, selection, and awarding of the good guy. So that means one parameter is removed. That's a max SPL. That is transformed into a maximum voltage. So everything is much more, I can update here my software. I hope you will not see that. I will not do it at this moment. Okay, so that's much simpler if this is already, no, I dislike that here, so okay. Benchmarking at the target value, what means that? We see for the two products, they have the same max SPL, the same target value, and now the other values are different. And this case means that B produces less distortion. So B is closer to zero in impulsive distortion measurement with a chirp and with a broadband multi-tone measurement. Yeah, but we have here with B more compression. You have to decide what is more important for you. Yeah, so it's still quite complex. Yeah, what is here the idea? The idea is very simple, getting best audio performance with compression, with distortion for a given max SPL. That's a very nice approach. Customer defines a max SPL. Customer and supplier defines the measurement conditions. He can speak about that. There's usually a kind of negotiation between the partners because even the customer can learn something from the supplier. And why should he not listen to the supplier? That makes a lot of sense. So that simplifies the communication between customer and supplier. Supplier can provide all test results to the customer if there is a confidential a relationship between, they trust each other and something like that. Okay, then minimum test effort for the customer if he likes. So the test results of the DUTs are comparable. What is the drawback? Max SPL has defined before the product development begins because max SPL is so important, it will affect that. And here you see it's a very nice thing between transducer manufacturer and system integrator. If you have an OEM business, that means a special transducer is made for the system integrator. So that's a very good way. Yeah, and now I can actually, I could go to the database, but the database is not so interesting at this point. You see, it's very similar to the first measurement. The only difference is I put the same SPL numbers in the multi-tone measurement where I measure compression and distortion and so on for the two speakers. Yeah. So I generate more or less the same output with the two speakers. Of course, the voltages are different. For instance, here the Arctic has a lower voltage sensitivity from the analog input to the acoustical output. This is a little bit more sensitive, but this is the difference. So I can save the time. Maybe you are happy if I'm speaking not too long. Here you see the results. So that means what is interesting. The two speakers have the same output. Yeah. And now actually the Arctic has a little bit more compression than the JBL. Yeah. The JBL has actually, here is something wrong. He has less distortion. I should put it down actually because it's lower. Also the competitor generates more distortion. Yeah, that's quite important. And here you see the result, the impulsive distortion ratio, also where the peak value from the impulsive distortion is quite low, minus 40 dB. That's fine. But again, here the Arctic has generates some impulsive distortion. Okay, but it's small. If we are doing the same measurement with a single chirp, you see again the same result. We get a little bit more, but still okay, it's fine. Some impulsive distortion, but the crest factor goes up. The limiters and compressors are working. So, okay, that's more or less the result. Now it's simpler for you to compare. We could neglect that. So that means you have to make your decision what is a better speaker based on the compression and based on the distortion. Yeah. The difference is not large here, 3 dB in distortion and half a dB in compression. No? Okay, some questions to the second method?
Maybe not particular to the second method, but one I think is a good overall question concerning Max SPL. Is the amplitude compression included in the Max SPL? And if it is, why list it separately? And if not, why is it, if not, it's reducing the Max SPL. Right.
The point, and it depends. We have to say it depends. Why? If the compression comes from the limiter immediately, without delay, then you cannot avoid that. That means the definition of the Max SPL is that really the product, at least for a short time, if the voice coil is cool and all the conditions are nice, should be capable of doing that. If in a long-term testing, the voice coil is heating up, or some other things are occurring. Maybe the amplifier has a problem. Is also the heat of the amplifier is too high and some thermal protection from the amplifier kicks in. That is allowed. So that means it might be that the long-term compression is even higher than the half dB, which comes directly from the nonlinearities and from the compressors.
Good. So Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Okay, now the third method. That simplifies very much our decision at the end, yeah, our awarding. We have three suppliers. They are providing some speakers. So now the whole story starts, but the spec sheet and so on, that's not important. We need the samples. The customer defines the target conditions, the test conditions, the criteria. Of course, he considers the standard. Why? Because that is quite important. If he has a problem and would like that the supplier improves one speaker, then he refers or he sends his data directly to the supplier and he can go on with that. And then he gets the test results and he does an individual rating of each unit. We end up with different SPLs. And then it's quite simple. He looks just to the maximum number. That's it. So that means all the critical thing about how to consider the distortion is a compression. That's under the test condition, actually in the limits. Yeah, and the limits is a very hot topic. That's why I will spend on tolerances. I spent a whole section, number 14, just on the limits. But before we are speaking about the limits, comes all the perceptual and cognitive stuff. That's that are section 12 and 13. So for the moment, let's assume we have those limits. And I have already some good guesses which work for some speakers, for most speakers, but it depends on the target application. For instance, here you see it, a good number is 3 dB for the amplitude compression. That's already significant. Yeah. Normally by heating, you will hardly get it not in a micro speaker, maybe in a pro speaker. Then it makes maybe sense going down to the compression to 2 dB or even 1.5 dB if your voice coil is very close to plastic and so on, then the thermal heating might be dangerous. So you see already this limit depends on the speaker target application. Okay, and we should be in this region here. Everything is allowed, but if we are hitting this limit, we stop the measurement. Yeah, the same for the multi-tone distortion. Minus 30 dB is not really an audiophile speaker, not a high quality speaker, but you could live with that with a multi-tone speaker. So it's a very pragmatic value. Yeah, and with the impulsive distortion, we should actually, we say if this is minus 40 and lower than 12 dB, then you might have already an impulsive mechanism, an irregular mechanism, but we say it's so small in amplitude, we could say, or in peak values, it's better, more precise, but it's peak, it might be peaky, that it's not worth speaking about that. So if it is minus 30, it's already something. You should work on that. Yeah, so maybe from the audibility, you can easily hear it at minus 30 if you have a very sensitive signal like a chirp or something like that. No? Okay. Yeah, and now we get here our loudspeakers or objects A and B. And what is interesting, speaker A or B in some of the criteria here, also not in max SPL, but in impulsive where we have limits, will hit the limits. Speaker B limits hits here the compression limit, and speaker A here on the multi-tone distortion limit. Yeah, that's the whole idea. Also that's here the limiting, yeah. And A is clearly the best product because by considering the limits, we get the largest output, quite simple. So what is the idea here? Just that maximum SPL for a given or defined audio performance limit. What are the benefits? Can be applied to any product. Customer can define the test conditions. You get, if you set very clever the limits, you get sufficient audio performance. If you make it really clever, you make also you are not at very low levels. You take the limits sufficiently high that you can bring also some other benefits to the users, not only audibility and perceptual audio performance, but also size, weight, and so on. So it's quite critical to set the limits in a clever way. Yeah. So that simplifies very much a decision in benchmarking. What are the drawbacks? Usually it's some test effort on the customer side. And this is less useful for application where audio performance is more important than max SPL. If you are on an audiophile business, high end or something like that, big boxes and so on, then max SPL is not so important. Then use the other things. Yeah, what is the application? Professional equipment, small portable personal audio equipment, smartphones, where max SPL is desired. Okay. Now let's show here very shortly the idea from the demo. That goes quite quickly. I close here this section, and now we are going here to the Ach, I forgot something. We have here from the last measurement a nice comparison. I would like to show that. Also that's not benchmarking from the last one. Here we measured the two speakers at the same level, 74 dB. And that are here the impulsive distortion measurement with two chirps. So that means the limiters are activated, but that's at very high level. And the interesting point is that the equivalent distortion, what really happens in the transducer and how a controller should compensate the distortion are so similar. It's unbelievable. It could be the same transducer or something like that, or the same design. They are apparently are in the same Bluetooth market. They would like to generate the same sound pressure output with the same size. This higher peak here at 100% was just at the cancellation point from the fundamental. Please forgive that. You don't find it in the equivalent input distortion. So be a little bit careful with the total harmonic distortion. Here, the higher order distortions are a little bit better in the JBL driver. So we, but it's still small. But this corresponds a little bit with our problem here in the impulsive distortion. The competitor generates already here at maximum level much more crest factor than JBL. It's much more impulsive. But here the peak values are comparable. Here from the competitor, it's here still almost minus 40 dB, only 3 dB larger than the JBL one. So that's not a big deal. Okay, in the multi-tone distortion, here you see the two curves. It's also quite astonishing how similar the distortions are. Why? Because they maybe are using a similar voice call length, similar suspension. The competitor has some more distortion here at lower frequencies. That might be related actually to the suspension. Suspension can only produce multi-tone distortion at lower frequencies, but here in the full band, they have the same behavior. That's more or less from BL. Inductance is negligible, and that are here some higher order modal vibrations. And there's a competitor also maybe 10 dB higher in the distortion than the JBL. So that's quite interesting. And now the benchmarking from our third method. I would like to show it here quite shortly. Here's the idea that we are using in the multi-tone limits. Yeah, actually we are stepping here with 1 dB and starting in the small signal domain, going up almost to 1 volt. And we are applying some limits here. The first limit is activate or stop the measurement if the compression is more than 3 dB. Here you see from 200 Hertz up to 5 kilohertz, we allow 3 dB compression. And for the multi-tone distortion, we are searching for the maximum value between 100 Hertz and 10 kilohertz at minus 30 dB. And we can save the time. We do the measurement again and again. And here you see the results versus voltage. Very shortly, I make it large. The compression went up immediately here. I'm now here in the Arctic, yeah, at 1.4 dB, and it stays on this level, yeah. And finally, we had here distortions about minus 30 dB. So the interesting point is actually the distortion here at minus 30 dB. There was a limiting factor, not the compression, no. Yeah, that's the result here. It goes quite fast. And here you see also the distortion versus voltages. I make it large, oh no. That's now from 2 volt up to 45 volt in 1 dB steps. And here we reached actually the minus 30 dB limit. And the same can be looked here into the norm, in the normalized frequency response, that's noise. That's why I set the limit here. Why? Because the fundamental is down in the noise region below 100 Hertz. And here we searched for the mean value of the compression. What was not a big deal. Do you have any questions to the measurement?
No, none right now. Thank you.
Okay. Then we are almost at the end here of my presentation. Here are the results, sorry. First, with a steady state measurement, two chirps, that are our limits. Yeah. And you see the JBL hits the compression limit. He has a very good limiter in it, and you can completely overdrive the loudspeaker, and that's why we get only 74 dB out of that. So that it was rated to 74 dB, but we can get a half of a dB more if we can lift this 3 dB of compression, but that makes not much sense. So that you see already, we need the freedom for rating the dBL, the maximum output, considering the huge amount of compression what comes in from the DSP and from other things. So the distortions are very low, minus 36 dB. They are so that means still in the allowed region, and we are still here above here the limits from the impulse of distortion. Nice speaker, yeah. With the JBL, yeah, does it with the Arctic? We get actually if we are really you applying here the limits, we get only 1 dB more. And now we are hitting here the distortion limits at minus 30 dB. Yeah. Of course, we have only less than 2 dB compression. So we have really a nonlinear problem in the driver. We have to pay for that for 1 dB more output. Yeah, that's a result with a steady state. If I switch over to the, so that's the conclusion, competitor Arctic 1 dB more output. If I make a transient measurement with only one chirp, then we get no higher peak value. We see only the higher crest factor. So that's it. Now to the summary. The IC standard provides a lot of new useful methods and measurement techniques for generating characteristics which are just optimal for benchmarking audio products. The rated max SBL or the rated voltage are a very easy characteristic for testing and benchmarking. Yeah. You should think about that. Also, the effective frequency range, which is not new, it existed already in old IC standard, is a very nice way for defining the linear distortion. Then we are working here with a new IC project with mean deviation from the target response and so on. If you are interested to join the IC group, please do this via your national team group in your country, usually someone from this group reports also at the AES, at other conferences about the progress of this new standard. So you get the information at least from me. Yeah, amplitude compression, multi-tone distortion, and impulsive distortion. They are the interesting three things for assessing the large signal performance. No, quite interesting. Limits for the last method, we need limits and permissible tolerances for those metrics, and we have to speak more about that, and that comes in the next sessions. Do you have any open questions?
None that are open. Boy, every time...
Or discussion.
Right. Every time we finish with these, I can think of a number of different questions that I have, but of course, it's always nice to go back and listen again. I'm kind of pulling some toggles and reading some things on the inside. So I highly encourage everybody to go back and listen again. It's fun to do it when you're not during your work hours, and it can be a little bit more pleasurable. And wow, I guess we'll be talking to everybody when it comes to August. I have been home for 3 months now, so it seems like it's still June, I think, or March. I don't know what it is. I'm all confused. But I'll let you wrap it up, and we'll talk about what's going on next week.
Yeah. What are the open questions? We have spent today only on physical measurements for benchmarking. How can we link those standard measurements, physical measurements, and the standard is limited really to physical measurements, yeah, to the perceptual world. Yeah, and that's why we are speaking in 1 week about oralization and perceptual evaluation. So that's very close to doing listening tests, but in a very, very interesting new way. So we are addressing how to test audio systems with ordinary audio stimulus. We are combining perceptual and physical measurement using any music signal speech, how to separate linear time varying nonlinear distortion from the desired signal, in a dense spectrum, and how to combine the two aspects of testing, physical and perceptual, and how to evaluate the masking of distortion. That's quite hot, interesting stuff. I hope you enjoy that. Yeah, please join that. I apologize a little bit that I'm now really filling 90 minutes almost, but you see the rating was so exciting and I spent some time with that and found so interesting stuff I would like to share it with you. Yeah, thank you for staying with me.
Right. You did mention something about AES. We know that CES is done now, but will you be doing any presentations at AES or discussing these topics in more detail?
Gregor Höhne will present an interesting paper about control and other things. I will not in person present something at this.
All right. It's all going to be virtual anyhow.
Yeah, I'm busy here still with my webinar.
Wonderful. Yeah, right. All right, everybody. Well, thanks again, Wolfgang. It's great to see you. We'll talk to everybody in August. And thanks for attending again. Talk to you soon.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.